going to talk about how to get to level 11 of continuous humor. So let's get into it. So first of all, what is continuous delivery? Just a reminder, what does it mean? Then how can we turn it to level 11? So how can we get the most out of continuous delivery? And in the end, I will tell you why you should. So I will start with this phrase, which is something that Dan Knotts said or wrote in a blog post. And I like it because it, it's one of the reasons why we do continuous delivery. And I think the most important time is the most important parts are minimizing lead time and also business impact. So business impact is basically what we do when we deliver a software. We try to give an impact into the business in a positive way. So like increase revenues, get more users or things like that. And we want to minimize the time that it takes from someone having an idea until it gets into production. So that is the goal of software delivery, and I think that's a precursor of why we use techniques like continuous delivery to get it done. So what is exactly it? So there is this two different concepts. I don't like this one because it's just too technical, I would say. So what I call continuous delivery is what most people call continuous deployment. So it's an automated process. Since you push the code into the repo until it gets into production, it's a completely automated process. So I'm not going to talk about this. I'm going to talk about that. So to minimize the lead time. So it's the time that goes from here to there. You want to shrink it as much as possible. Of course, there are things that are north of here, like deciding which features, how the team will build these features, get some analysis on those features. That's also important, but the part that I'm going to focus more on is how to minimize the time things to get into there. So how long should the process of getting from beginning to end take? 2 hours, 1 hour, maybe 5 minutes would be a nice goal to have. So I'll explain a little bit about this pipeline a little bit later, but we should have in mind that 5 minutes, it's actually a very good goal to have in terms of push into production. So that's continuous delivery at level 11. How do we turn it into that? So let's start a little bit before getting into the pipeline, which is how do we define user stories. So ideally, we want the user stories to be small. If you have big stories, people tend to disperse, but also they will take more time to get into production. And it increases a little bit of risks in terms of, there might be some that have bugs, things like that. So you want to start off by, shortening your user stories. They're not too short, so maybe like a sweet spot, I think, is between half a day and 2 days of, real work, not ideal work, but real work. That's a size that is acceptable, I'd say. Then we need a board that promotes the flow, because we want it, the flow of things to go into this direction, and we should as well get that into the area before, so that it can just happen as well afterwards. Another thing that is important is to have work in progress limits. This is to avoid things clustering and becoming bottlenecks. So you want flow on the system. That's what you need, so that you minimize the time. So the time that things stay in the backlog, creating inventory and probably rotting in here is time that could be focused, and redoing this work would be time that could be spent in other tasks. Yeah, given that you already have the the flow going, so now you need to focus on the small stories, and by that you would create PDD tests, and then you would implement the story using TDD. So this allows people to focus exactly on what needs to be built now, rather than getting a little bit distracted into other things. What else? Well, yeah, we have the TDD that helped us out, focus. But now we need to start committing more often to, to start sending those stories into production and getting benefit from it. So start committing more often. Maybe ideally also push, important part, push. And one rule of thumb that we have in certain projects is that you should push twice a day at least per stream of work. So what that means that you would get at least two pushes into production every day. If there's more streams of work, of course, there's going to be more pushes into production. Okay, so you're pushing to production, but you're pushing things, but maybe they are not ending up in production because you are in a branch that doesn't go into production. But that's no good. Also, we'll have the problem of someone pushing a feature and then someone trying to get push another feature, but there was refactorings here, so you're going to be having a lot of time wasted on a feature that should be in production by now, and you're just wasting time trying to fix problems with integration and all this stuff. So try to, if we put everything in master, we will be able to then take advantage of the things going straight into production without any delays or any invariability or variability here of how things will turn out in here. Yeah, so cool, we're pushing things in production, but how do we review the code? Well, pairing is what we use to review the code. So this basically avoids people having to wait for pull requests to be pushed. This also avoids rework, so stories going back and forth because it's not good, it's not as good as we wanted. So delaying stories from being put into production. So two people looking at the code, they will more often than not produce better code, and it's automatically reviewed and can be pushed to production with a little bit more confidence. Another thing that helps is to have a mono repo. So this is to avoid us getting distracted with versionings of things. Like, oh, what version is this library, or what version is this part of this dependency, or this microservice, or something like that. We will know that if you use the monorepo, that the commit that is on the head is actually what is in production, unless the build is broken. So it frees time to or at least your mind in terms of managing all this stuff. Also, you get refactorings that can be done across systems, and you have this atomicity. So any change in multiple systems can be done in one go. So this will help you, basically, not having to do a commit or a push into production in multiple phases. You can just do it in one stage. Okay, so we're pushing things in production. We have a monorepo and everything, but how do we make sure that the things that we pushed are not broken? So you have to run smoke tests. You have to run smoke tests in the several environments, including in production. The smoke test cannot be too big, otherwise you will not hit the 5-minute mark. But they need to be enough that the people have confidence that what's in production is not broken. So if people can do the, you know, the more important tasks, they need to be able to be verified by the smoke tests. Okay, so pipeline. Let me explain again. So what we do? You take the Git repo locally into the build machine. You identify which parts, because it's a mono repo, you identify which parts have changed. So if only one microservice changed, you only deploy that microservice. You don't deploy the whole thing again. Then you build, run the tests, and create an image for it. Deploy that image into a QA, whatever, pre-prod as live environment. Then you run all the smoke tests in it. If they pass, then we can promote that to prod and run the tests again to make sure that everything is fine. So that's the quickest way to get things in production. And then you think, okay, so what about exploratory testing? We have testers, how do they do this? So there's not a single way of doing this thing. There's multiple ways, but one of them is, for example, once things are in production, then the tester will just basically go to the QA environment anyway, go there and test explore to see. We know that the system is not completely broken, because otherwise the smoke test would have failed, but he's free to verify some edge cases. If he finds something wrong, then he should create another card, be prioritized on the board, and then get it through the process again. How do we demo these things to clients? Sometimes clients want to have. But then again, to go back, we can also demo things in prod. Okay, they are already in prod. We can say, hey, here's what's in prod. Sometimes demos, they create data that we don't want in prod, so we can do demos as well in QA. And because the systems are the same, there's not going to be any difference in terms of what is in what. Cool. So how do we get this to work? Because sometimes features are not finished. How can we put things in production that are incomplete? Especially if you start working on a story and it's and you do the first commit after 2 hours, how can you do that? So you use something called feature switches. That's one way of solving it. Basically, you commit the code behind the feature switch, so it's off, basically in the beginning, and then when the feature is complete, instead of turning it on, you just basically remove the feature flag. There's no, usually the feature switches are to be used so that people can turn them on and off in production, but actually you can use them as basically just hiding code behind some flag. Another way to do it.
Sorry. You can turn them on testing environments and on.
Yeah, you could do that. But what we use mostly is this thing, branch by abstraction. So this is an example. So imagine that you have an old component and you want to change it somehow. So instead of breaking this stuff and not being able to deploy, what you do is you create a new component that does almost the same thing but a little bit different. So you build this component, it's not attached to anything. At some point, you basically just change from using the old to the new, or you can put the two together working for some time. And then when you're happy that the new component is doing the right thing, then you can just remove this old component, and that's it. So you move the consumers, they don't actually see any changes. The behavior is encapsulated in those areas. So yeah, that's basically it. So in order to get your continuous delivery to get to level 11. Just try to shorten the stories, use Kanban to avoid wasting time, use TDD and DDD to increase confidence on the code, get small commits to get faster feedback, use trunk-based development to reduce the variability or the wastage in terms of time to get things into production. Take a monorepo to augment the factory tool that they forget about versions, so you don't have to worry about them. And importantly, the smoke test, distinguish what is valid from invalid deliveries. The pipeline, it's important to reduce human intervention, which usually causes mistakes and errors to occur. And control the delivery of the features via branch abstraction and feature abstraction. So that's the way to do it. So why should you do it? Well, exactly because of this. Because you actually want to deliver value as quick as possible, because that's how companies actually, you know, get ahead of the other of the competition. So you want to give the possibility of companies to be quicker than their competitors into market, and deliver the best features as quick as possible. So that's it. This is the reason.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So can you have continuous delivery without continuous deployment?
Yeah. Continuous delivery without continuous. Yeah. I mean, if you look at here, you can, but I was just speaking about continuous deployment as continuous delivery. But yeah, you can automate this last bit, and that would be continuous.
Well, one of the problems we have is that they will deploy every 2 weeks or so. And because it's exactly a time frame, sometimes we do trunk-based development, and there is some stuff that it's in master that is broken for specific functionalities. But because they only do deploy like every 2 weeks, it will stay broken for a while. So how, using this approach, how can we deal with that?
Yeah, so first of all, the master can never be broken. Because imagine this case.
It's not to build, it's a specific test. You don't even have that many tests anyway, but it's a functionality.
Yeah, exactly. But if the build is broken, you have to find out why is it broken. And you shouldn't be doing that. Because then you're wasting time that you should be coding. So the build should always be green. And for one specific reason. Imagine that you have a problem in production, you need to deploy a fix. So one way is, okay, you branch out from production, then you have a fix, but then you have to apply it again, the fix, into the branch that is in master, but it's broken, so you spend time figuring out if there's impacts on the, and also you don't know if your change actually broke master in another way, because the build is already broken, so it's you know, like it opens a whole complete can of worms, so you don't want to go that direction. So you should always have the build green. Even if so you hide things in no, it's too far away. You hide things in these things. Always green, make sure that you either have feature switches or a branch.
Okay, my corollary is that you need to have sufficient maturity. You need for example, if you don't have tests, there's no way you can talk about green builds or whatever.
Because if you don't have this, okay, but that's okay. You have less confidence in the code, but that doesn't mean that you can start building it as you go. Nevertheless, you can still use those things even if you don't have tests. You can use these things anyway.
Because the broken feature that you were mentioning, is it the feature that you're building?
Sometimes it happens, we build the feature and we think everything's okay. We don't have tests for lots of stuff. And later on we figure out, this is broken in a very specific way. And we normally have to wait until the next deploy cycle to make the fix. So because the tester didn't get it, or we don't cover it with some kind of tests. So my point is that I have this belief that you need to have reached a certain maturity in order to apply continuous delivery. Otherwise, it's like
continuous delivery or continuous deployment. Because what sounds like to me is that you're using continuous delivery, but you're not doing continuous deployment.
We're not doing either anyway. My point is, I think you first need to have like a way to test some things, mm-hmm. TDD or whatever, but have a good way to validate things. Then you need to have, for example, a good deploy cycle, continuous delivery or whatever. Then you can do continuous delivery properly. Because if something doesn't work, you will have, my experience is that you will have problems.
Yeah,
that's why I was asking.
But I agree most with Muno, because even if you don't have tests, you can do continuous deployment. You're just not very confident on the outcome.
Yes.
Yeah. So you can do it. You can deploy the build. The signal that the build is broken is when the users start complaining.
Nevertheless, you can always start. You can always start by writing some tests, some small tests. So at least if something's broken, it's not completely broken.
We're working on that.
Yeah. So if you start with this, if we start with this, then there's some confidence. Then you can build the rest of the bits. But what can't happen is to have the build broken. As in like tests that don't pass. Even if they're testing things that are not there yet, that shouldn't happen.
No, that doesn't happen in this project.
Yeah, we have some tests. I have a question regarding the version. We said that this is always monolithic. But when you're dealing with some sort of modules that implementate between multiple microservices, are you saying that you should like copy the code to keep
Monorepo is one repo. So it means that all the code, when you check out all the code, including, you know, microservices and their dependencies.
Oh, I see.
What happened, if you have code that is shared amongst more than one microservice, what happens is that when you change that code, you have to rebuild that part and the microservices and deploy the microservices.
There's only one project with all the code.
Yeah, that's what monorepo is. It's one project. With you know all the code of the project is in there.
Yeah, for certain projects that might not be.
No, usually the thing is it's not being used a lot, and some companies are not yet open to that. But it helps out. It's a way to help out with. Like I said, especially in the factoring between modules, making sure that if something, for example, if you change some module that breaks someone else's code, then you know your commit will not, you know, like you commit your part and it breaks the build, so you have to fix it. So it encourages people to make changes that are backwards compatible.
Yeah, no, I understand and I agree with that. I'm just saying that there are some projects which the dimension of which is not allowed to have one.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, Google and Facebook, they do it. Windows does it. They had to change Git for it. But
do they have one
yes.
repo?
They have lazy file fetch.
So they had to. They reached the point where they were too big, and they had to actually change a bit of how the internals of Git work. But if you get halfway there, it's still comfortable.
Exactly.
Be really huge to say you cannot do it.
Exactly. More questions?